very much for the opportunity to speak here. This has been a really great conference so far. I'm going to be talking about work done in collaboration with James Gray at LMU, Andre Lucas at the University of Oxford, and Bert Overit here at Penn. And this is based on a series of papers that have come out over the last 2 years, specifically one from last October and one from earlier this year, and one that's about to appear. The context that I'm going to talk about is probably familiar to most people at this point in the conference. I'm going to be discussing the E8 cross E8 heterotic string in 10 dimensions, or equivalently heterotic M theory in 11 dimensions. And in order to discuss this 4D physical theory, I need some geometric ingredients. Mathematically, I need to specify a Calabi-Yau threefold as a compact space to reduce my 10-dimensional theory down to 4. I also need to specify a holomorphic vector bundle on that Calabi-Yau, whose structure group is a subgroup of E8. And the presence of this vector bundle is going to break E8 down to some smaller group, which will be useful for 4D physics, and hopefully lead me to an n equals 1 supersymmetric theory in 4D. The way that the presence of this bundle breaks is because G is a subgroup of E8, the structure group of this bundle, this presence breaks E8 into a direct product, G cross H, and the commutant of G inside E8 will be the low energy gut group in my 4D theory. For the purposes of this talk, I'm going to be interested in G equals SUN, where n is 3, 4, or 5, and this is going to lead me to E6, SO10, or SU5 guts in 4D. I'd also probably want to go further with this for realistic physics and introduce Wilson lines to break this down to something like the standard model spectra. But for this talk, we won't worry about Wilson lines. We'll just stop at gut theory. Importantly for this talk, the 4D physics that I'm interested in, the matter and the moduli of that theory, are specified by this internal geometry. So specifically, things like the charged matter, quarks, protons, all the interesting things I'm interested in 4D, are given by some bundle-valued cohomology groups that live over the Calabi-Yau. And there are also uncharged matter, things that are singlets under the visible sector gauge groups. And these have geometric and bundle origins. Specifically, these are the familiar geometric moduli of the internal space, the Kähler and complex structure moduli, as well as massless degrees of freedom that are arising from the bundle itself. These are degrees of freedom in the connection, integration constants, in the connection of this bundle over the internal space. From a physics point of view, the presence of uncharged massless degrees of freedom in the 4D theory is a problem. This is unphysical, and we need to find a way to get rid of these, to stabilize them and give them a mass in the 4D theory. So although the heterotic theory has a lot of useful ingredients for doing 4D physics, you have grand unification, you have potential for n equals 1 supersymmetry, realistic matter spectra in 4D, you need to worry about moduli stabilization. So that's the framework that I'm going to be discussing in my talk. Before we talk about stabilization, though, we need some ingredients, which is that I said I was aiming for an n equals 1 supersymmetric theory in 4 dimensions. And in order to accomplish that, the Gugino variation in 10D tells me that the gauge bundle on the internal dimensions has to satisfy some properties. Those properties are the famous Hermitian-Yang-Mills equations that Professor Yao told us about earlier in the week. And these have two parts. The first part is that the two not and not two parts of the field strength have to vanish. This is just the familiar holomorphy condition. And this contraction of the Calabi-Yau metric with the 1-1 part of the field strength also has to vanish. And this is in the correspondence to slope stability that we've already heard about. For the purposes of this talk, something to point out is that what I called the moduli of the 4D theory, the Kähler complex structure and bundle moduli, all of those guys appear in these equations. And in general, some regions of moduli space, the connection on this bundle will be such that it solves these equations. And for other regions of moduli space, I will not have a solution. So it is, in fact, somewhat misleading to talk about moduli if they don't satisfy my equations of motion. So I'd like a more detailed understanding of how these equations affect the local moduli space of my theory. In order to see that some regions of moduli space will give me a solution and some not, and what will happen with that, I'd just like to point out that it's clear that from a 4D physics perspective, when you fail to satisfy these equations, you're going to grow some dangerous aspects of your 4D potential. So if you begin with the standard Yang-Mills coupled supergravity Lagrangian in 10 dimensions, you can play some tricks with the Bianchi identity to rearrange this to pull out some familiar terms. So here F1 and F2 refer to field strengths of the two E8 bundles. And you can bring out a set of terms, plus some other stuff, that are exactly the Hermitian-Yang-Mills equations. So when you fail to satisfy these equations, because these terms do not depend on any 4D derivatives, you're actually going to be growing positive semi-definite terms in the 4D potential. So these will be non-trivial lifting of a vacuum. So you know that these will have a strong effect on your 4D theory, but this might seem difficult to determine because you don't know either the metric on the Calabi-Yau or the connection on the vector bundle explicitly for virtually any example. This has only been done numerically for the most part. However, you can make progress, and I want to talk about part of that progress in this talk today. So I'm talking about all the moduli, but because I only have 20 minutes, I'm interested in just one half of these equations for today. I'm going to look at the seemingly simpler half of the Hermitian-Langmuir equation, which have to do with holomorphy of the vector bundle. So, as I said before, if this equation vanishes, we call the vector bundle holomorphic, which means simply that its transition functions are holomorphic functions. Now, we can ask a very simple question, which is suppose that we begin at a holomorphic starting point. So we have a bundle that is holomorphic with respect to some fixed complex structure of the base. We can ask what happens as we vary the complex structure of the base to this equation. Must a bundle stay holomorphic for any nearby fluctuation if I just expand the complex structure in some basis, so delta z is some arbitrary element of the complex structure? If I allow a fluctuation of the complex structure, must the bundle stay holomorphic? And the answer mathematically is trivially no. So to see that, it helps because I've written this in terms of complex coordinates. Here the barred and unbarred coordinates are the complex coordinates in the Calabi-Yau. It's easier to see this fluctuation if I do this in real coordinates. So to pull that off, I can write projection operators, C and C bar, that are built out of the complex structure template. So here this J squares to minus 1. I can rewrite the Hermitian-Yang-Mills equation in real coordinates, and I consider a fluctuation. So I want to see what happens to this equation under a change delta J in the complex structure tensor. And at the same time, I'm going to allow a fluctuation in the connection of my vector bundle, and I want to see if I can choose this in such a way to keep the bundle holomorphic. So if you just do this fluctuation, plug it into those projection operator equations I just had up, then written in terms of the original zero complex coordinates, you have the following equation to first order, which is very simple to understand. There is simply a rotation in complex structure contracting the 1-1 part of the field strength, which is basically turning a 1-1 piece into a non-2 piece. And you also have some fluctuation of the connection, which is not D-bar closed. So these two pieces can both give you nearby a 0-2 contribution to your field strength. And you can ask, can I find, given some fluctuation delta z, can I find a delta a such that this equation vanishes? If I can, then I still have a holomorphic vector bundle. If I can't, then the bundle is not holomorphic. And the answer is that given an arbitrary delta z, there need not be a delta a which compensates. So the big idea of my talk is going to be, okay, bundles don't need to stay holomorphic as I fluctuate complex structures. How do I actually determine practically where they're holomorphic and where they're not? And how can I engineer that to my advantage to get rid of moduli in my 4D case? In order to do this properly, I'm going to need some deformation theory. So there are, in fact, three objects in deformation theory that are of interest to us. When we talk about deformations of some compact complex manifold, this is a very well worked out structure dating back to the 1950s. And there are a lot of familiar objects in play. So specifically, the Calabi-Yau itself is a compact complex manifold. And if I ask what fluctuations of that manifold preserve holomorphic transition functions on that manifold, you can answer this question to first order. This is just familiarly H1Tx, which is H21. These are what we call the complex structure deformations of X, simply the complex fluctuations of X. Likewise, we can ask what are the fluctuations of a holomorphic vector bundle. Now here's the key point. The deformation space of a vector bundle, which are just these integration constants in the connection, are evaluated for fixed complex structure moduli of the base. So if I hold the base fixed in complex structure moduli, allow the connection to fluctuate, it turns out those infinitesimal deformations are just measured by H1 and V, where this is traces and endomorphisms, here equivalent to H1 V times V2. These are what I called before the vector bundle moduli. However, for physics, for the actual 4D physics, I'm interested in a third deformation space, which is really the simultaneous deformation space of the bundle and its base. So I want to allow simultaneous fluctuations of the fiber and the base in such a way that the total system stays holomorphic. And happily, this space is also simply described to first order by some local cohomology. Let me call it H1Q, where Q is some non-trivial mixing of the tangent bundle of the base and V tensor V dual. For those of you that haven't seen it before, this is defining Q as an extension of these two objects. Q is related to the projectivized total space of the bundle in a detailed way, which I don't have time to get into. But these guys, these simultaneous deformation space, these are the objects that are interesting for 40 physics. So let's look at that in slightly more detail. This technology was first worked out by Atiyah, and the short exact sequence is known in the literature as the Atiyah sequence. There is an associated long exact sequence in cohomology, and this guy is what I want to see. I want to see what is the dimension of this thing, what does it look like in terms of my familiar moduli. H1Q can be simply written in terms of some map from H1, an object I'm interested in, into the familiar complex structure space, as the bundle moduli plus something I don't know, this MD pi. If this map is surjective, then the moduli is simply locally the direct sum of what I thought it was before, all the vector bundle moduli plus the complex structure moduli. However, d pi need not be surjective, and in fact, by exactness, I can shift this unknown map to something a little easier. I can shift this over one and say that this unknown image, which need not be all of complex structure space, can in fact be written as the kernel of this map alpha, where alpha is simply the 1-1 class of the field string. This lives in this cohomology here. This alpha is known as the Atiyah class. So let's just see what I'm saying for a second in terms of forms. I'm saying that the actual moduli in complex structures, not the entire complex structure moduli that are allowed, but some subset of them, that subset is determined by this equation here. It says that a complex structure modulus multiplied by alpha had better be zero, but zero in its target space, which is in fact a cohomology. So to be zero in cohomology simply means that you're d-bar of something. So I have this equation here, which, if I just relabeled the unknown d-bar of something, I reproduce the original fluctuation equation that I showed you in terms of projection operators. So, morally speaking, I've turned this differential problem into an algebraic one. I simply have to use the Atiyah sequence, determine H1Q, and I will be able to see what complex structure moduli are fixed by the presence of the bundle. So intuitively, you can imagine this as deformations where you try and pull the base some direction as a complex manifold, and the fiber just can't come with you in that direction as you try and deform. Note that in this picture, the vector bundle moduli are unaffected. They're definitely in the game because there's an injection from H1NV into H1Q. So what we're really interested in are the complex structure moduli, the free guys, which are the kernel of the Atiyah map, and the stabilized guys, which are its image. So I said that I can translate this into an algebraic problem. I want to use tools in computational algebraic geometry to actually directly compute this kernel and image for a given vector bundle in blob F. So the question we really want to answer is, what is in alpha for some given geometry? How many moduli are fixed in the presence of a given bundle? So let's start really simple. It turns out that if you were to ask this question for a line bundle, the answer is immediately obvious. The image of an Atiyah map for the line bundle is zero, so all line bundles on Calabi-Yau threefold will deform with their base. So line bundles aren't so interesting. Let's make it slightly more interesting. Let me consider an extension of two line bundles. This is an SU2 bundle that is simply a non-trivial mixing of a line bundle and its dual. This is just a gluing of these two guys. I'm going to do this on a very simple Calabi-Yau manifold as well. I'm going to do this as a 3-3 hypersurface in T2 cross T2. It's a familiar bicubic manifold, and it has Hodge numbers 2 and 83. Specifically, I'm going to build this SU2 bundle, this non-trivial extension. The degree to which this V is not a direct sum of these two pieces is actually measured by its extension class, which is simply line bundle cohomology in this case. Now, you could use Benjamin's nice code in order to compute what this line bundle cohomology is, and you would find that it is zero, generically. Hence, the bundle that I want to define cannot be defined at an arbitrary point in complex structure moduli space. So this seems like a nice one to start with, because I know this thing feels the complex structure in a big way. What happens if I move to a special point in complex structure moduli space is that this cohomology can change. It can jump from being zero to non-zero, and at special values in complex structure moduli space, I can define this bundle. So you can explicitly solve for where this cohomology is non-trivial, the extension class, and you find that on a two-dimensional locus in complex structure moduli space, that's only 2 out of 83, this thing can jump to be 180-dimensional space. Just as an aside, this is an interesting manifold to work with because you know that you have MSSM spectrum models on this space. So let me just show you very briefly, this is probably familiar to most people, but very briefly, how does this jumping take place? In this case, I have some ambient space, which is a product of 2p2s, and the causal sequence that Benjamin was just mentioning for us defines the line bundle cohomology on the object I'm interested in, my Calabi-Yau, in terms of two ambient space guys, where the map between the two is, in fact, just the defining defining polynomial of the Calabi-Yau. So as I change that defining polynomial of the Calabi-Yau, I will change where this cohomology is zero and where not. The question I have to answer is, given some initial defining 3-3 polynomial, where is Perfi non-zero? Now, the point that I want to make with this is that, in fact, for even such an extremely simple example, this jumping substructure is incredibly rich. If you just analyze this very simple computational question of where this cohomology is non-zero, you find that within complex structure moduli space, there can be hundreds or thousands of even disconnected components with different jumping behavior. So for one line bundle or one Calabi-Yau, there are a lot of options for how this can change. But what we really want to do is, noting that all this structure is here, noting that this bundle depends very strongly on complex structure moduli, you want to actually do the Atiyah computation, begin at a point P naught for which this extension class is non-zero, and actually compute the image of the Atiyah map and find out what happens. And in fact, we can do this computationally. We find that here M alpha is 81. So the presence of this rank 2 SV2 bundle stabilizes 81 out of 83 complex structure moduli. What does this look like in terms of 4D physics? Well, there's actually a very simple description of what this bundle is doing in terms of 4D physics. Using the familiar Gukov-Vapa-Witten superpotential, you realize that the heterotic freeform H depends on omega 3 Young Mills as well as omega 3 Lorentz. This omega 3 Young Mills is a function of the connection on the vector bundle, and in general, in a Minkowski vacuum with W equals 0, this term can generate F terms of the form derivative of the superpotential divided by field, where this field is a vector bundle modulus. So I can do a dimensional reduction on that, actually analyze the fluctuation of these F terms in the presence of the general type of fluctuation I've set up, and you find that you can reproduce this familiar first order deformation problem. So in general, in terms of the 4D physics, when you're stabilizing complex structure moduli with the presence of a holomorphic vector bundle, what that looks like in 4D physics is some non-trivial F term in the 4D theory. Now, the scale of that F term is moduli dependent, and through most parts of moduli space, this will actually be stabilized at the compactification scale. So these moduli are well and truly gone. However, in some regions of moduli space, this can be light, and you can actually use the 4D physics to determine things. Big point that I want to raise here is that in this description, either F terms or geometrically, the stabilization that is occurring is perturbative stabilization in a supersymmetric Minkowski vacuum. And it's topologically trivial. I have introduced no geometric flux on the Calabi-Yau background. This is still a Calabi-Yau, still here. So there are three approaches that you might want to use to try and determine and engineer complex structure stabilization in the presence of a holomorphic vector bundle. The most straightforward, in some sense, conceptually, is to directly compute the Atiyah class, compute this image of this map alpha as I've defined it, and decide, given some bundle, how many things have you stabilized. The problem with this is that it is generally pretty computationally hard. Likewise, the field theory involves solving F terms, which are very moduli dependent and frequently also difficult to determine. The third way, and the reason I showed you this jumping of cohomology, is that in many cases it is possible to isolate how a bundle structurally depends on complex structure in a very definitive way. So the example I gave you of this extension bundle, its extension class jumps with complex structure, and you can see where it's zero and not zero, and compute that much more directly. So intuitively, you might expect that if you could isolate exactly what jumps with complex structure, that you could try and bypass the difficult computation in terms of an easy one. This requires some proving, though, and the work that is about to appear is that we, in fact, prove in various classes of examples that there is structural jumping that can be isolated and proved to be equivalent to the Atiyah calculation. So much progress can be made by looking at examples whose very definition clearly varies with complex structure. In forthcoming work, we're going to describe how this can be done, not just for extension bundles, as I've outlined here, but monads, special covers, and here in Maruyama constructions as well. OK, since I have 1 minute left, let me just say the punchline and where we hope to go. The observation mathematically is a very simple one and is well known, that in general, bundles are not holomorphic for all complex structure moduli of their base. From a physics point of view, that has strong implications for what you can do with model building. In fact, the moduli of the heterotic compactification are not what I put on my first slide. They are, in fact, the Taylor moduli, the bundle moduli, and some subset of the complex structure moduli which can be computed. This leads to F terms in the four-dimensional theory, and you can use either of these viewpoints to determine that the complex structure moduli can be stabilized at the perturbative level without moving away from a Calabi-Yau manifold, stressed it here. In the example I had, I got down to 2. It can be found point-like solutions to that same manifold. This involves a slightly longer story, but you can actually stabilize all of the complex structure moduli using this mechanism. And this is a novel new idea. Unlike flux vacua in heterotic, which did not work as well in general for moduli stabilization as in type 2, this allows us to keep the toolkit of Kähler geometry. You are allowed to stabilize moduli and still be able to do everything else that you know how to do. And we hope to be able to present this as a straightforward and computational tool. You can not only stabilize moduli, you can determine which values they're stabilized at. For all known classes of Calabi-Yau, we can generate very simple hidden sector bundles that could be used to stabilize these moduli. And we hope this is an important new tool in heterotic stabilizations. Thank you.
Any questions?
Really, I wanted to get back to you, and I think in your previous slide you said most of them get stabilized in compactification scale and then some go light. And is it really just a two-scale thing? Do they just go very light? Actually,
so the scale of where the moduli are stabilized, almost everywhere in moduli space, the mass scale of these fields will be at the compactification scale. You really have to actually tune yourself down to get it lighter. You have to choose things very carefully. However, it's useful to be able to show that there's a 4D physics description. Otherwise, they'd just be gone and you never had any description of the problem. Other questions?
I guess I had another question. As a function, do you ever have this, I don't know if you ever computed this, can you compute something as a function of the FABs, the actual field strengths? The deformations and the field strengths.
So the field strings, morally speaking, are the F terms in the Fourier theory. So yes, you can explicitly determine those F terms.
Do you know what the range of how large that field gets to be?
The scale of the F term breaking that you would have?
Yeah.
Yes, generically it's at the compactification scale. Again, you have to tune it to be able to do it.
How hard is it actually to compute the image of outline in the explicit terms?
So doing the full Atiyah computation is extremely difficult. It's doable using programs like Singular and Macaulay. You have new Grobner basis computations you didn't have before.
Okay, so the Grobner basis.
There is also Grobner basis calculation. The hard part though is actually not the computational one. It's determining what alpha is as a function of the moduli. So I told you its class lived in a particular cohomology, but you have to figure out what class. So just mathematically, if you have me an arbitrary bundle, it's difficult to determine exactly what that is. We know how to do that for simple classes of bundles in general. That's a bit of a trick. If you can do this alternate approach that I haven't had time to discuss in detail, you can actually prove theorems that show you there are easier ways to get at the same information. So practically speaking, for most constructions, you don't have to do the direct hard work.